So today we'll review the last class, whatever we have done, and basically this I'm telling you, this is basically the development of automata and formal language is not done by a chapter wise, like chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3 in all books, whatever you find. So that is one of the main thing I also want to teach into the class. I generally do not teach chapter wise. I top down approach I teach, so that what is the basic thing you have to learn and try to do it for top down approach. Here also, if you think if you see the history of computing, it is also basically 1936-37 the concept of Turing machine comes by Alan Turing, and that is still now the one of the ultimate machine we have. We until and unless we have a quantum computing exist, quantum computing also coming up like anything. So till now this is the model, but strange thing is less developed ideas like finite state machine, which is a basic rudimentary concept, though definitely it was known to Alan Turing, but he is so advanced, he developed at a time not only finite state machine and the Turing machine at a time, nobody has done it. And in fact the 1940s and 50s, this all these finite state machine, the minimization of finite machine, this various application of finite state machine, Mealy machine, Moore machine, all these things concept is developed. It is 1940s and 50s. Remember, this is already Turing machine is conceptually is there, and lots of computers also in this 50s and 69 concept with this machine. Turing machine also is developed in EDVAC, ENIAC. These are all the computer architectures. Probably you have seen your computer architecture classes. Then this is the one interesting theorem that will actually this is make a sea change. Cook introduced intractable problems of or NP-hard. What is intractable problems? Tractable problems means polynomial problems. What is the polynomial problem? Like your sorting and all kinds of sorting, say come from insertion sort, Owen square algorithm to merge sort, n log n algorithm, these are the or sorting algorithm can go maximum to n square, and then comes the binary search, that is if it is already put in a binary search tree it can be log n, you know. Then the next is the matrix multiplication, that is generally O n cube or O n's. These are the polynomial problem. Then other is sorting I have told, and these are all n log n or log n problems. Log to the base 2, and that you I think probably you are finding it your data structure course and algorithm course already. Another thing is that complexities come n cube at most. Then the then I have told you this is the problem of the Tower of Hanoi. I think I can show you Tower of Hanoi. I think yes, Cavendish Tower of Hanoi. It is 2 to the power n problem. Okay, 2 to the power n minus 1. Like if you have a 3 disk, you need 2 to the power 3 minus 1. That is 7 moves. If you have a 4 disks, one to another, you need 2 to the power 4 minus 1. That is a this is the intractable problems. That is basically whenever the n goes to the power, that is called the intractable problems. So there are lots of like I have told you this NASH scheduling problem in any hospital, and that is also a intractable problems, tough problems. Like your routine, and it is a tough problem because not only your teachers, your nowadays one problem is solved, that is classroom problem, but your teacher, then our teacher availability with other departments, other teacher availability, particularly mathematics department, they are very busy, they are taking class from the various departments like IT, computer science, so you have to give at least one period break between two classes. So all these problems, it is cannot be done by a simple algorithm. It is algorithm is basically kind of ad hoc, and this is the ad hoc algorithm. As you know, it is computationally very high cost. It is not an n square problem. It can be 2 to the power n, like our traveling salesman problem, 2 to the power n factorial n problem. These are called basically intractable problems, are NP-hard problems. And there are some problems are there, I have told you, that is Turing halting problem, that is unsolvable problems. There another unsolvable problem you probably aware of, that is if the two context-free grammars are there of a same context-free language. So I think you have understood what is difference between language and grammar. Okay, a language is examples of the sample string, and the grammar, which rule you can set these strings. A language can have many grammars. Okay, it is one to many combination, and it is very it is not solvable. If the two grammars are equivalent or not, you have to only show by examples. There is no direct proof that it can be the 2-3 grammars are equivalent. It will be shown this. Yeah. So it is whether the graph. So this is another problem, unsolvable problems. That is, I have told you another unsolvable problems is brick. So if you have a picture, you make it a randomized split by say 16 pieces or 32 pieces. If a simple take as a rectangular pieces, then you try to rejoin this picture to get, probably you have all done in your childhood, to get a picture out of the boxes or piece of cardboards. That is also, there is no algorithm. It is basically what we are doing, we are trying to get it and see it whether it matches. Then we have to, if you have a 32 pieces, you take one piece and then rest another one of 31 pieces and see it whether it matches or not. That is the way. That is, you can say, is a process, but that what is the difference between algorithm and the process is, algorithm, it will work on many samples and you can prove it correct only maybe few samples and it should work. It is not, you have to again go for 32 pieces, you have to again say you have break it in 64 pieces, you have to go bring it back and all these things. But our whatever the daily running course or whatever the programs, whatever in the real time, that is done by also ad hoc way. Okay, the ad hoc means there is you are try and fix. Okay, so these are the areas where Turing machine, concept of Turing machine will help. And modern computer science is compiler is one of the most modern computer science problem. That is a fallout of this automata and formal language theory is the compiler theory that we'll see. And the complexity theory, we have already touched the topics and we'll go to this. So today we'll discuss about the pills and more towards push down automata and then the ultimate Turing machine and side by side the languages and the problems, and we'll solve the problems. So let's see the next slide. Basically, what is computer? It is a you can say input data, garbage in and garbage out. Yeah, that is basically a computer. Probably you all know. And there resides your program. That program depends on algorithm. That is our traditional computer science is. And here, if you see it here, let's see. Yeah, this is a computing devices. I think you all know slide rule, abacus probably. So some of you have done some abacus in your younger days. And that can solve the problem. And it's very interesting way of multiplication. These are, I think you have all, in the computer architecture, these are the basic thing. And then comes the first computer, 1941 in Germany. ENIAC is very famous computer, probably you have heard, in Pennsylvania. It is von Neumann is there, who knows the main architecture, the von Neumann architecture. We are still following von Neumann architecture and in our computer science. And this is PC, come 1980s. MacBook, this is the 2008 has come. There are two kind. This is the 1800 and 1900 computer, and these are the comes really after 1940s. So what is the difference between this? So that is interesting. These computer are all in one class, and 1940s there's a separate class of computing devices come. We already discussed, but let's see. This is not programmable, that is the main thing, and this is programmable. Not programmable means this is all basically finite state machine. Okay, this they are powerful, but they are finite state machine, but they have reached their capability. You whenever you want to get more out of it, then you had to need to program. That is, you need to program, and you need to program means you write a string of terminals, that is a programming language, and push it to a machine. The one program, it will understand that instruction and decode the instruction basically and execute it. That is the fundamental thing of computer. That the programming is done by language, you probably all know. The first computer language is assembly language, and then the Fortran, then come the Pascal, then the very popular in 1971 by Dennis Ritchie, the C. Still you are learning, that is one of the fundamental computer language, C. Then 1991 Java. The Java is more popular in 94-95. You'll all have to learn Java. And 1990 is developed by the Python. It is now also very popular. Now it's a basically close race between Java, Python, and C is always there. So what are the basic things? That you can code this machine. You can code this machine by a programming language. And for programming language, that means you need repeated computation. It is not, you have to do manually. How many number of repetition of computation, how many recursion, you need to automate all these things. Then you need a programming language. Programming language is nothing but a formal language, and it must act, this machine must work unambiguously. That means sometimes it work this way, sometimes it that way, that then it will be disaster. So this programming language should be unambiguous. So that is, you probably, we have all understood that it cannot be done by a regular language. Regular language cannot detect the recursions. Regular language cannot know that a to the power and b to the power, or parenthesis. It cannot matches the opening braces and closing braces. That is the most fundamental in any programming. You have opening braces and closing braces. Probably you are missing it Python, but Python inherently it is there by invisible white spaces. That is the invisible indentation and invisible white spaces give you basically opening brace and closing brace. If you see in Python language, if you mistake one or two spaces, it will give error. It will give some syntax error or something like that. So what I want to mention, that is, you need this language that is called the deterministic context free language, that we generally called is parenthesis grammar. Same is deterministic context free language, that parenthesis grammar, or a to the power n, b to the power n. So this you have to remember, these are the two grammars that will give immense powerful to this machine. In principle, these all have the same problem solving capability. So these are all the languages very popular. C++ is also very popular language. Java, you know, Python, Lisp is the artificial intelligence programming languages. And everywhere, the Turing machine concept is there. So basically, I have told you, basically your laptop is basically a Turing machine, where your CPU, whether it's a quad CPU, it is basically nothing but a finite state machine with hundreds of registers. In our 8086 architecture, that is basically your laptop, it can be have some around 32 registers. If you have a quad core, if 32 into 4 registers, or maybe 64 into 4 registers, and there are various other registers also, that is basically nothing but a finite state machine. And your RAM, maybe 4 GB or 8 GB or 16 GB, it is basically your strip or paper strip with a block, and your finite state machine is there, and that is your basically a Turing machine. So coming back to the this is the one thing I must tell you, the this concept of context free language is fully developed by Noam Chomsky, and the machine is developed by Anthony Weitinger and Schutzbacher. They are both German scientists. They developed in concept is 61-63, but 61, it is 1961, the concept is already cleared by Noam Chomsky. So you can take the three main, that is Anthony Weitinger and Schutzenbacher and Noam Chomsky, and you probably aware of Noam Chomsky is still alive and written very powerful article, if you see in Google, regarding like Palestine conflict. He's a basically anti-capitalist, and he's from a great linguist, he's a great political commentators. He still very much delivered. Anytime Noam Chomsky writes in any journal, that is, he everybody acknowledges that is still alive, is there. So he developed this language concept, and he also the Pushdown machine. So they are basically same. And one thing you must know, that every context-free grammar can be identified a Pushdown machine, and they are basically equivalent. So any context-free grammar can be have equivalent Pushdown automata, and any Pushdown automata has a context-free grammar. So basically, one is the same as a finite state machine. One finite state machine have a regular language, and one regular language to one finite state machine is a 1:1. This is finite. This is the stack. This is goes to concept is infinite, and we generally concept in most of the our theoretical discussion. There is a one stack alphabets as input alphabets are different. Stack alphabets we generally take different. The input alphabet we generally call the sigma, you probably know, and stack alphabet we generally take a gamma, capital gamma, and the end of stack marker we generally use the Z0 in some of our next discussion we see. And what we'll see, the finite state machine will come to the input of the screen here, maybe it starts from left and come to the end here, and then your stack should be empty, and this FSM state should be in accepted state. Then we'll say this string is accepted. So only one stack. Remember, there is only one stack is used. You can, for argument's sake, if you say if you have a dual stack, if you have another stack, say a to the power n, b to the power n, and c to the power n. I push a here and I push b here. So then for each C, I pop one A and pop one B. So it can be another Pushdown automata with two stack version, but very difficult to control those two stacks. So generally, this is a Pushdown automata, only one stack only, not two stack or multiple stack. That doesn't enhance the power of the Pushdown automata, and more power. Like it cannot detect WW language. I have told you WW or A to the power N, B to the power N, C to the power N language. They are basically context sensitive grammar that can be done by a Turing machine or linear bounded Turing machine. That is called linear bounded automata. That is more powerful. There the stack is not required. That is very strange. That is probably, but there the power is come because the head can move left and right, and you need not to go at the end of the string. Anytime if you go unaccepted state, then the string is rejected. So it can be done. So the Pushdown automata. But if you see, if that is so powerful, the Turing machine is so powerful, why use the Pushdown automata? But Pushdown automata, we'll use it because it is most efficient than Turing machine. Turing machine's power is more, but it is less efficient, I should say. And same as the FSM is much more efficient than PDA. Why it is efficient? Because if you have A to the power N B language or A to the power M B to the power N language, M and N no relation, then the finite state machine is the quickest, more responsive, it takes less memory. We use it, finite state machine, probably you know, for catching identifiers, for catching integer, floating point, or if then else token, what is if, or how to get the keywords in our syntax analysis portion. There we all redundantly use the finite state machine, and finite state machine are excellent there, and so use it. So in computer science, we use it appropriate hardware and appropriate language appropriately. So we do not use PDA where FSM can be done, or where you use Turing machine where PDS can be done, because we want efficient things. One thing I must tell you, this is what is this? This is, I think it is visible. I say, let's see. Yeah, what is this? It is basically a stack. This is, I think, some of your, if you have grandparent, or if you have a grandparent at your house, not your parent, they generally use this kind of thing at your home, I think. Your grandparent or great-great-grandparent, they generally, other than files, they use it. And my father used it, and she generally kept here the electric bills or municipality bills, which had to be paid regularly, and all the paid bills. At that time, no soft copy version was there. Hard copy comes to our electricity bill, and we pay it, and we and whenever it is paid, it is keep in stack. And what is the advantage of stack is last in, first out. So we can see it, what is the unpaid portion, and that is very easy thing, and it can be kept. This is basically concept of stack. This is also a concept of stack, this portion. So stack is a beautiful concept in computer science. Without stack, you cannot solve. Stack has many use. I don't know how many use you come across. One thing is, if you want the repeated function calls, if you have a your CPU, always in fundamental machine, we always take the concept that the CPU is one and only one, and you have a stack. So if your process is on, if you process calls another, all the CPU registered variables associated, we push it into the stack, and then we work on the new things. And if there is any other interrupt comes, or if you press your keyboard, that is interrupt goes to this to your computer, so it pushes again into the stack, and when it is coming back, it pops it and loads into the registers, do the job, then again pop it. So all whenever a process calls itself, that is called recursion, a program calls itself, so all the things, it will be the stack, and it will again pop and comes out. So without stack, it is not possible for any functions, repeated function call, or you can say the recursion. So stack is very much needed there. So you cannot see a computer architecture without stack, any hardware architecture. There definitely one stack or more than stacks. One stack, one is system stack, one is the user stack. All stacks are there. At least one hardware stack. Then we can make the software stacks also. So one hardware stack must be there, then there will be finished. Another user stack is whenever you have the graph traversal. So if you want to, you know, the graphs, you can a node can have many childs, and left child, then I go to the left of left child, then is the left of left child, and that is called depth first searching. And if you go first parent, then child, then elder child at the left side, then the second elder, then the third elder, that is called the breadth first. That is the breadth first, and another is the depth first. I go to the first child, then first of first child, then first of first child, then again come back. So in the depth first searching, which is very essential in computer science, it is done through only stack. And the breadth first searching we done by a list, a queue. So depth first is always by a stack. So stack is used there. Then in Pushdown Automata, you come to know that is stack. With stack, you can detect a to the power n, b to the power n language, and parenthesis language. This is another thing I have told in the last day's class, that is the whenever in the parsing, you need only stack whether it's accept or reject, but also you have to get the parse tree. What is the parse tree? Parse tree is the how from the start variable you generate the, you got it the sentence. You are given only the sentence consists of a terminals and the grammar's rules. That's all. Now your duty of the compiler syntax analyzer, first stage is lexical analysis. It will create the tokens. What are the tokens? If you go to the any ICICI bank or state bank, big state bank, you go to the counter, you have to first get a token, a paper strip, and the what is your number, and there is a billboard is there, it will tell you, please come, your token number 37 is coming there. That is basically token. Whenever you go visit a bank, a state bank or ICICI bank, you get a token. The same concept here in the compiler, whenever the syntax analysis is there, all the instructions, all the variables get tokens. So that is the reason we have told you, I have already told you, give a variable a big name or legible name, no shortcuts, so that you can, that is a dis, that's and all the better you don't use camel case. Camel case means start with the capital, then small, then start with the capital, small. No, it is better to give an underscore instead of camel case variable name. And you have a uniform variable, and if you have the variable is a kind of a constant, put it in capital. So by the naming of a variable, if it is explicit and if have no shortcuts, like if you have a numbers, you spell it numbers, not NOS. That is, this shortcut you should not use, but some programmer use no, some programmer use number. It is better to give the full name. So that doesn't extend the size of the program. Basically, ultimately, they are all reduced to a token. And the token is generally maybe 0 to 65k numbers. So that doesn't take any extra space. All so, but it is legibility of the computer becomes more. So that is the advantage of the tokens. And then come the syntax analysis. And the syntax analysis, you get a terminal, you get all terminals string, a sentence is given. Now, from the syntax analysis, one thing you can do from the, you can see from the left hand side, and you can see the start variable, and you want to try to match the derivation rules. Then last class I have told you that if it's the S grammar, fortunately with S grammar, S grammar is one of the simplest way, to parsing, because S grammar, you remember, it is a basically Graeber form. It starts with a, must start with a single terminal, or is only one terminal, a single terminal, and all our rest are all variables. And that terminal, the terminal, that rule should be unique. So there are only one rule with that beginning with the terminal. So if you see it from the left hand side, you can at once fix the rule by which it can be derived. Okay, so if you know it is from S grammar, so you can very straight away top down parsing, and from that is called LL1 parsing. I'll tell what is LL1. So basically, from left side, if it is S grammar, your parsing will be very simple O(n). But that is not the case, because all our programming language cannot be done by S grammar, and then it will be very peculiar looking. Your programming would be difficult. Generally, we generally program like expression syntax. Like, what is expression? I have yesterday I also told you the class E is equal to E plus I, E plus plus E plus E, E star E. So this is infix notation, basically. That is, human can understand infix notation, but we probably have known that postfix is better for computer, because if you convert all these our expression in postfix, you do not need the brackets, you do not need the parentheses. But if you say, if you tell your programmers that we don't have infix notation, we have only have to write it postfix, the programming will be tougher. So all our aim in the programming language, why the Python is become popular, because Python is easier to read, is very readable, very legible, very comprehensible, because programmer's time is costly. So that is the thing, we do not forsake infix notation. But for computer, infix notation is difficult. Postfix is much easier, because it is easier. So then also you see the stack is very important role. So for parsing. So yesterday, last class, we have covered the top-down parsing by left to side, and there should not be any back and forth. You try with one, and then it go back. No, it is wrong. It is go back. This is there. That is called brute force parsing. But generally, we programming language, we try to avoid this brute force parsing. So every step we should take, that is a deterministic step. But it cannot be done by only S grammar. We'll see a certain set of deterministic context-free grammar that is called LL1 grammar. LL1 grammar, what are the characteristics of LL1 grammar, we'll come to see. Then we see that by with a stack only, you can get the parsing tree. But the last class I have already covered also bottom-up parsing. Why I'm telling this top-down parsing and bottom-up parsing, because that will be more extensively covered in our compiler design class in next semester, probably next semester or next semester. That is basically extension of this. There you see the bottom-up parsing. We try to match from the right, not from the left, and try to match the from the right and try to go to the S symbol by bottom-up approach, and that is more powerful. And your language can be, and that call grammar is called LR1 grammar. So, but anyway, both the cases, stack is essential. So till now, I have covered the use of stack, and stack is very much useful everywhere. You will see lots of other cases also, stack uses are there. So one portion is the ambiguous grammar. So some grammar is inherently ambiguous. I'll give examples. Some grammars, whichever way you cannot put it, unambiguous. So we have to, we do not take this this ambiguous grammar for any programming languages. Now, see the this zero look ahead LL0 is a very smallest set, not useful basically, because very less powerful. So if you see the next set of LL0, that is LL1, is one look at, is much more powerful, and much more more powerful is LR1. So it LR1 covers most of the 98% of the programming languages. So basically all our programming language basically LR1 grammar. LL1 also powerful, so LR1, and if you go for more LRK, but we not require it. LR1 is enough for basically unambiguous grammar, and then you can ask why not this kind of programming language. We will not use it because it's too much resource hungry for any compiler. So LR1 is enough for us. This is LR1, the most powerful shift reduced parsing, left to right scanning, rightmost derivation, that I am calling here. We try to search rightmost derivation, K look ahead, we will take it one. LR parsing is most general non-backtracking shift reducing parsing, but it is still efficient. The class of grammar that can be parsed using LR methods is proper subset of the class of the grammar that can be the predictive parser. So LR parser, more powerful. More for it can cater and it can detect your syntactic error much. So why you are learning this context-free grammar? Basically, all programming languages are basically LR1 grammar. That summarily I told you. That is the reason of the why you are studying formal language. With a fixed number of, minimum number of states, they are only one and only machine. Okay. Are you getting my point? That is 1:1. Any regular language, regular expression can be, one machine can have a regular expression, one to many. But if you have a simplified regular expression, and then you can map only one and only deterministic finite state machine with minimum state. If you allow number of states, then maybe one, then many, many to many. Okay. Any regular expression, simplified regular expression, can be mapped with one and only deterministic finite state machine. And if the question is asked that you have to get the deterministic finite state machine with minimum possible of steps, then your marks may be deducted. But it is that is the point. Okay. But thank you very much.